Battle Wolves. I was raised by the wolves. I was raised by the wolves.
All right, folks, we are back with another edition of the Red and White Podcast. I'm your host, Evan, here with Will. It's Miami game week, and it's actually tomorrow. We're a little late with this. Will's been out scouting signs for the Miami Hurricanes, like Connor Stallions. Will, how you doing?
I'm good. Did I blend in well on the sideline?
I mean, your leopard skin pullover looks, I mean, you can't even tell. Can't even see it.
Yeah, perfect. Yeah, perfect. I mean, it's a unique look, you know. What can I say? I can't believe he was on the Central Michigan sideline. What a wild twist.
Isn't that weird? It was the Central Michigan game, and he's like in a fucking disguise wearing glasses that people are speculating now are the recording glasses that you can wear.
Yeah, let's game this out. How does no one from Central Michigan know that there is a random stranger on the sideline standing like right there next to you? Doesn't that seem really hard to believe?
It all seems hard to believe. They had to be complicit in it, but what benefit they probably got is paid. That? Yeah.
I guarantee you, they're probably like, here's $100,000 or whatever. There's probably some stupid thing. Or, hey, we're gonna send a recruit your way. We're gonna, you know. I'm sure there's some quid pro quos going on there.
100%. Had to be. It's so weird.
Yeah, that's insane. But I love this guy's effort. This guy probably deserves to be head coach. Wrote that incredible manifesto. Goes all out for the team. Just wants to help them win. Clearly has an effect. I mean, look at the record after he started doing this. I mean, this guy should really be setting up shop everywhere. Yeah, so that's what I was doing. I was down there. I was actually sneaking into practice and trying to film Tyler Van Dyke throwing into zone coverage.
How'd that work out?
That was great. I mean, you know, they're used to no one being there, so they were like, oh, a fan. This is great.
Somebody's watching our games.
Oh, yes. Man.
Yes.
Speaking of, did you see the Duke Wake game?
Parts of it. I didn't watch to the end.
I tuned in at the end. I didn't even realize there was a game going on. And they did some crowd shots, man. It was so pathetic. There must have been like 80 people there.
Oh, I did see the crowd shot. Yeah.
I mean, how the hell does this always happen to us? Like, right? We play them at a night game. Everyone's losing their mind. Their backup quarterback somehow hits this guy for a couple passes. Then fast forward several weeks later, it's the second backup quarterback now, and the star wide receiver's dropping passes left and right. And no one's there to watch. I was like, come on. Why not us? Man. Just killed me.
That's where Duke season has gone at the moment, right? I think there's just a lot of dejection. Yeah. And now
best thing that could ever happen.
Yeah. I mean, let's be real, they're not a real fan base. They don't care about basketball. Even then, they have, 400-seat arena that, whatever, people think is great.
Honestly, we should hope that they somehow lose out and Louisville loses out, and somehow we freak our way into a bunch of wins here, and all of a sudden we're in the championship game with who knows who our quarterback would be at that point, Evan.
Oh, teaser.
Ooh, that's a tease.
Teaser. Yeah, I mean, let's be real, and this is, and I have this conversation with James Henderson all the time, is why do you think you're better than Duke? And I'll give you example A, there's nobody at the stadium, and I know they don't generate the revenue that we do, and it just makes me, I hate losing to Duke. You should never lose to Duke. I don't care what statistics say, and it's the same. I feel the same thing with Wake. F them. Should beat them. Nobody cares about them. At least State has a fan base that cares.
Well, yeah. Evan, you're going to get your chances because there are partners again in crime in the new schedules.
It's true. Yeah. We probably should talk about that new schedule coming out. And I really didn't mean to record a 10-minute take on it, but life gets in the way.
It's all right. You can record an hour and a half take on it now.
Let's go. Yeah. I mean, first of all, it's weird, and that's you know, putting all that aside, the schedule next year seems extremely winnable. If Dave is really sticking around to get his last win to get the record, if he doesn't get it this year, he sure is getting it next year because there's a lot of opportunity there. Once again, opportunity for NC State. I mean, I thought there was opportunity this year based on how the schedule set up. You know, are we going to capitalize on it next year? But that schedule is interesting.
Well, dude, if he doesn't get the record this year, I mean, that is going to be a nuclear hot seat with the with Wake. And, you know, I mean, VT has had a little bit of a run here, but I expect them to probably lose this weekend and they'll be a little bit more normal. But I here's the thing, right? Like, you look at those future schedules, I actually don't mind it. I know as like a fan it probably stinks because the home games on certain years are like really weak. But right. Watching wins is also fun. So maybe counterpoint to that. But I think it kind of sets up just how it looks every other year. Like, there are going to be some really good fighting chances for us if we can continue to maintain relative stability as a team. There's going to be definitely some opportunities to win one year. Or if you lose a bunch the next year, it's not a death sentence. But the odd years are going to be a little bit tougher. I'm looking at them right now. Like, yeah, 2025, FSU, GT, UNC, VT, Duke, Miami, Pitt, Wake. But then the follow-up even year is Cal, Duke, Louisville, Wake, FSU, UNC, Stanford, VT. Like, so it gets a little bit easier. And I think we see Clemson every other year, basically, still.
In 24, we got a couple of new guys. Carolina doesn't play any of the new members. And I was like, oh, that's interesting. And then in 25, we don't play any of the new members, which I also think is interesting.
Yeah.
I guess that's just how the rotations break down. The one team I'm concerned about next year will be SMU, because, my goodness, they have – Rhett Lashley's been putting up some points for that program. I mean, they just put a 66 burger on somebody the other day. I'm like, oh, and they weren't even trying.
Yeah, I need to look. One of the teams, I thought, like, it almost looked like they were, like, FU, and they just, like, smashed them.
Yeah.
Maybe it was Cal. Yeah, Cal walks into Miami, State, Stanford, Cuse, Florida State, Pitt, SMU, Wake, and then it doesn't get much better for them. But,
yeah,
you know, who cares? Cal should be, like, they should just be like, you know what, you're the one that's definitely not bringing anything to the table. So, I mean, I hope they just decimate Cal into obliteration. SMU, definitely. Don't you think? I feel like SMU out of all of these is probably the biggest winner if everything goes to plan, right? And I feel like they are going to be a thorn later, especially as the money starts coming back into them at the end of that contract. But I'm not going to really look too far ahead, right? Because we looked into the 3-3-5 model, right, and saw all these projections for X amount of years of schedules, and 1 year later, that's out the door. So,
yeah,
you know, something tells me we probably aren't going to see the schedules in 2029, is my guess.
One of the things I wanted to mention, this is kind of unrelated, but I was talking about Duke and Wake Forest. My buddy Sam Jesse from Sons of Saturday Virginia Tech podcast tweeted out something last night during the Wake Duke game I thought was interesting. Wake Forest is now going to finish 500 or worse in the ACC in 8 of Clawson's 9 seasons.
Great coach. Great system.
Wild. That's wild to me. He pulled the wool over a lot of people's eyes, and I think the program was okay, and his thinking scheme makes it difficult for, you know, difficult to defend when you have the players that can execute. But man, he is, he's got a few letdowns in there. I'm sure if you look at it and you break it down, like a lot of people do, the NC State schedule, like, well, you had to play Clemson every year and you had to play Florida State every year, and
yeah,
you know,
and they were bad when he took them over.
Yeah,
so it kind of makes sense. But hey, counterpoint. They've at least been to an ACC championship game.
And a New Year's Six Bowl, so.
Yeah. So, I mean, the thing with Dave Clawson is they were able to scheme their way into relevance, but also they get the benefit just like Duke does, where if they underperform, it's kind of like, well, they're little old Wake Forest, as my stepbrother always says. And, you know, when they just put up a little bit of a fight or get an upset, that's a big deal to them. And they schedule as many wins as possible as you can in out of conference, with how they do their four games there, and how they sneak in like a P5 game against Northwestern or Vanderbilt or whomever. So, you know, they make it easy. I think they've had like a pretty long streak of bowls, if you care about that. And if you're them, they probably do, because they want the money. It'll be interesting, though. Like, do you think he's in line or consideration for Michigan State or something like that?
I think so. I don't know why you wouldn't. I know it's not the win the press conference hire everybody would look for, but, you know, the last couple of years, he's had Wake in that position, and it's definitely would have been a win the press conference hire. It's just, when you break it down like Sam did, it's just like, wow. That's,
yeah.
Yeah.
Well, James has been saying it for years, James Henderson. So, you know, he's always been like, what a great gig. I would say if they hired him at Michigan State, he's probably not going to have a dick pic. So, you know, it's probably as safe as it gets there, is my guess. You know, what's interesting is I actually was reading a random article or press conference from them, and he was talking about how they just now are getting their NIL stuff set up and how they were having a real big problem last year. And they were asking him, well, if you had the NIL, would Sam Hartman have stuck around? Could you have got A.T. Perry to stick around? And, you know, he was saying it, you know, not having it really cost them, and maybe they could have kept those guys around. So, you know, it's, I just thought it was interesting just hearing another perspective from a small school where you're like,
yeah,
do you really need it? Are you really getting poached that hard? But, all I could think about was, I was like, you know, is Wesley Grimes doing okay down there? Like, you know, can we maybe throw a tender to him?
Chicken tender?
Yeah, chicken tender, or, you know, a tender with money in it. And maybe we'll get a chance here. Maybe the coaches will accidentally talk to him, or they'll do what they did in the Beckham, the David Beckham documentary, where Zinedine Zidane or whatever his name is was like, "You come play with us," and that was it.
Wesley Grimes says 16 for 299 and 2 touchdowns.
Brother, what if I told you? Now you got me interested. Hold on, because I had the stats up. Hold on. All right, I'm going to our receiving column. Can you read that stat line one more time?
16 receptions, 299 yards with 2 touchdowns.
He would be second on this team behind Casey.
Holy poop.
Casey is at 42 receptions, 493 yards, 6 touchdowns. The next behind him is Terrell Timmons. Hey, maybe play him more. 10 receptions, 180 yards, 0 touchdowns. Behind him, Bradley Rosner. Behind him, Julian Gray. Behind him, Trent Penix. Behind him, Keon Lassane, who leads the team in snaps. Must be nice. Must be nice to have that, all those wide receivers and a really shitty quarterback, and somehow still have better stats than half of our group, or 80% of our group. Jeez,
that's crazy. He is 1, 2, 3, 4th on their team in receptions.
Oh my God, you're killing me.
I totally forgot
about him. Is Micah Mays playing for them? I think that was the wide receiver they picked up last year.
I don't see him on
that. We were after. I hope more than God. Wouldn't that be sweet if Clawson left and then Grimes and Mays were like, "Oh, hey, I see you guys suck at wide receiver. Can I join?" And boy, wouldn't that be great? And maybe we can get that kid that went to Tennessee too. What was his name? Oh, I'll have to go look that guy up.
Laycock.
Yeah. Yeah. But luckily we'll get to play them next year because we are smart and schedule really good SEC teams. What do we do on this podcast, Evan? Do we talk about Miami?
No, Laycock doesn't have any catches yet. He hasn't played.
Oh, man. See, check hasn't cleared. Come here. We'll pay you. That should be our message.
No joke. Bring that Tennessee playbook, too.
Oh,
man,
God.
I totally lost what I was train of thought here.
Well, we were talking about schedules. We were talking about Duke. We were talking about Wake.
Yeah.
We basically aren't talking about our opponent.
Okay. We played Miami this week, and I've watched a lot of Miami games. I really don't know anything about them because I feel like they're so schizophrenic.
Yeah.
They have a bunch of talent. They run the ball, and they play good defense. If Van Dyke is in, you know, Van Dyke was good early in the year, but then he's been hurt and then not good, and they've, you know, the Miami fans are down there calling for their third string kid now. What do you make of this Miami team and this game this weekend?
So I was trying to just get the quick confirmation of what his actual injury is, because I've heard lower body, but then I'm looking at an AP article that he says he's been dealing with an injury to his right hand, which is his throwing hand, and he has been dealing with a leg injury, the specifics of which have not been revealed. What was your question? Sorry, I was looking that up and I forgot to listen.
This is one of our better pods here. We got going.
Dude, it is Friday afternoon. You are lucky I have not popped open the whiskey. We are close to being off the rails.
What do you take for this Miami team and this game on Saturday?
Well, I tell you what, I watched that Virginia game, and holy crap.
Yeah.
So I was listening to a podcast earlier this week, and of course I do not have the stat right in front of me where I need it. But basically, teams in ACC play have just been sitting back in zone coverage against him. And essentially when they have not been in zone coverage, he's basically thrown for about 300 yards, 3 touchdowns, and 2 interceptions. And I think those 2 interceptions were against UNC. And then when people have not blitzed him, if I'm smart and can figure out how to use this Twitter real fast, not blitzed, he's 53 of 85 for 468 yards, 2 touchdowns, 5 interceptions, versus being blitzed, 22 of 30, 371 yards, 3 touchdowns, 2 interceptions. Wildly different per attempt numbers there. I can't do the math really fast, but let's see. 468 divided by 85 is 5.5 yards per attempt. If that's real, and not just, you know, recent injury related, boy, I would sit back in coverage, because if you watch the Virginia game, he looks just completely lost when everyone just sits back, and they were just rushing for, and you could just see it. He was just holding the ball and being like, I actually don't know how to throw to anything other than a one-on-one hot route, basically. And so, you know, then you go back and look at how we've decided to play him in 2021, I think is when it was. They call that his official launch party game, where we made him look like a freaking rock star. And then same thing with De'Aaron King the year before. It was just pressure, 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 and they made us pay for it. So I think the way you control at least Miami's offense is you sit back and you say, you know what you're going to do? You're going to have to pick me apart. And if you do, that's great. I don't think you're going to be efficient doing it. And I think you're going to make mistakes. And then likewise on defense, I don't know, control Ed Bain or whatever his name is. And, you know, just I would just do kind of like we did for Clemson. It's kind of the same game plan. They're going to try to pressure you. It's kind of like facing Duke, Clemson, and Miami all in a row is kind of, you know, it's like training wheels for each game. You know what I mean? And so,
mm-hmm.
I think we will be a little snappier on offense going into this game, but we're going to definitely still need the same playbook. We're going to need some really big explosive plays probably, unless this is finally the game where MJ starts becoming efficient, because right beforehand, I think they said we're like 10 of 40 with MJ Morris in third downs. That's really bad. So yeah, I'll pause and let you expand upon that knowledge bomb I just dropped.
Yes, I agree. We should not running blitz against them, against Van Dyke. That is, we learned that lesson. How many years ago was that game? 2 years ago? That makes me cringe every time I think about it.
God. Remember when he was like, I don't know what's so special about this defense. And we were like, we're going to fucking light this kid up.
Yeah, and then he torched us.
Yeah,
so
he looked
bad.
Like second coming of Troy Aikman back there.
That I still, like, to this day, get Miami fans commenting on the YouTube video that I put up. And they're like, ah, see? I told you. I'm like, gosh, that was 3 years ago or 2 years ago. Get over it.
That's what
we, was that last year or the year before?
Have we not learned? That was 21.
21, okay.
Yeah. Have we not learned? We should never, as a program, ever put any kind of video up before a game.
Yeah. True that. But he did it, not us.
I know.
I did it after the fact. And then he torched us. I was so mad. But, yeah, I mean, to me, the my biggest concern, one of the questions we had from the folks was, do we have over 200 yards of total offense in this game? And I want to say yes, but my confidence level in that is not great because their defensive line is really good. And like you said, Bane Jr. is unbelievable. As for a true freshman, he just bulldozes people. And I just got a feeling he's going to terrorize our offensive line. And we need to obviously move away from him and see how we can work or make his over pursuit pay between him and then I can't pronounce the other guy's name, Maagwa, who's got 11 tackles for loss. I mean, that is, their front is tough. And, you know, I felt okay going to the Clemson game because their offense is trash and I kind of knew what you were going to get because their offensive line's not good. I don't feel as great going into this Miami game because their defense is good. They have enough athletes that it's going to make it difficult for us. And yeah, I don't know. Like, it's, yeah, I don't have the same warm fuzzies that I had going to that Clemson game.
What's the weather Saturday night in Raleigh?
Cold, probably.
Yeah, I'm gonna take
35. Good luck, folks.
Starts at 56. By the end of the game, 50. Oh, man, I was hoping it was just going to be just a smidge cooler. Those Miami boys can't handle the 50s. Virginia was able to put up, I think, almost 239 plus 138. So, 377. This defense is not as good as Clemson's. So, they're beatable. But, you know, we just got to be smart. And it's kind of the same game plan again. Like, it's – they're playing FSU the week after this. So, as always, it's can Miami stay focused? It's on the road.
True.
They've had two back-to-back overtime games. You know, at least our offense is going to be fresh because we only were on the field like 40 times last game. The defense was a little bit more. Yeah, I think it's just simple. You cannot try to go like side to side and get cute on these teams that have just speed on us. So let's just see if we can, counter, misdirect, and go. And you know, I think I'm curious to see if Jordan Poole gets more run because I like the idea of trying to put someone super physical like Jordan Poole on a Bane. So maybe we're gonna have him more involved. I'm not sure if. I don't know if Mims was injured last game or not. I don't really recall seeing him much in the film. yeah, I just think it's simple. Here's the thing. It's a night game. They may not be as motivated. And they have Mario Cristobal as their head coach. So I think those are three things in our favor.
Yeah, you know, their last four games, they've given up 23, 41, 20 points, 26 points. So they give up points, right?
Yeah.
Georgia Tech, Carolina, Clemson, and Virginia. I mean, one of those is a competent offense. I'm not sure about the rest of them, but again, I don't know where we lie in that.
Well, Every other week, Georgia Tech is a good offense. You got to remember that because they lose, win, lose, win, lose, win, lose, win. I think, yeah, I mean, that's the thing. It's like, it's the same thing as last week. It's just, do you click and get all three phases working well? You know, is this going to be a Friday night clunker like the Louisville game, or is it going to be a Clemson game? You know, is Peyton Wilson healthy? Like, those are the questions I would have.
Yeah, I think the environment will not let us, throw out a clunker. I just think we do well at home, home environment, night game. All those things are playing in our favor. I still don't have a whole lot of warm fuzzies about it. I don't know who's playing quarterback for them. I watched that Virginia game, and they did not feel comfortable at all letting that that other kid throw the ball.
No.
And, you know, the end of the game, they had a minute and 45 seconds left, and they went full Dave Dorn and took a knee. And the few Miami fans that were there were like, what in the hell are you doing? And you're like, that zero confidence in it. And honestly, I thought they should have lost that game against Clemson based on just how that played out and the coaching decisions that they made and, you know, went to double overtime, et cetera, et cetera. But, you know, they're beatable. I just feel like they've got a bunch of talent. And, you know, Carolina, they've only lost to Carolina and Georgia Tech, who both have competent offenses. And it's weird to say that about Georgia Tech, but, yeah, I mean, they've been running the ball well and doing things they need to do.
I think they, like, have, like, a surprising explosive rate, like, per attempts, big play rate versus what you would think for a team that is 4-4 in Georgia Tech. So, I mean, that's the thing is, like, does MJ Morris, like, run the ball? Is, like, that final piece added to the puzzle? Because I feel like that's what's been missing, right? It's kind of crazy. It seems like we're almost, like, intentionally not trying to have him involved in the ground game.
Well, I don't think he's a great runner. I mean, he's okay. He can move a little bit. I don't think that's what you want him to do. I really believe, like we talked about post-Clemson, is that they need to continue to force it into the hands of the best players. And I'm sorry, MJ is not one of the best players right now. And I want them to take everything off of his shoulders and make it easy for him to get it to the hands of KC, get it to the hands of the other guys that can make plays. Like, that's Ant what Smith. I want to see. Take more shots to Ant Smith, get DPI. He should have two DPIs last week, right? We've been talking about it all season. Yeah. And, you know, starting to do it. But I want less on MJ's shoulders because he's making a lot of mistakes, or maybe not making the right, I don't say the right mistakes because he's not turning the ball over like Armstrong was.
Yeah.
But he's also not doing a lot of the right things.
Yeah, it feels like, it just feels like it's been drilled into him to not make a turn, just not have turnovers. Like, limit the dumb. And which is fine. But I just do wonder if that's making him kind of hesitate up or look off certain things that maybe in the past he would have just, like, let it rip. And that's what I keep saying. It's like, you know, we should, if we're being fair, factor in that, you know, he came in rusty against Marshall, then had to face Duke on the road, then had to face Clemson. Like, you get through Miami and all the other defenses on the schedule are going to look easier. Just, you know, just by the fact that you went through them, right?
Right.
And that's assuming he doesn't redshirt after this game.
Yeah, all right, so let's talk about this. Let's talk about this because I've been only vaguely paying attention to it, and I know the message boards have drummed this up. And, you know, we lost Mercy Felice, who's leaving, who was, I'm going to mess up his job roles. Well, he was like director of player personnel, and then he was a GM, and then got demoted back to some, you know, maybe the player personnel recruiting guy. Essentially the guy that scouts talent and organizes a roster. And which is something we have not been good at since Glasscock left to go to Texas, and the guy before him, who Drew Hughes, who was the one that we want ballers. That was his That was his doing. We had Cullen Homolka, who did a terrible job, and then they promoted Mercy in internally, I don't know, a couple of years ago. Anyway, you know, he's out in mid-season, which I think is weird.
Yeah.
It's not, you don't see much position movement like that mid-season. And is it, was it announced he's going to Maryland, or was it?
Yeah, it like came out today, I think.
Okay. So he's going to Maryland, and the timing of that is weird. But anyway, so now there's rumors of MJ playing this game, and then this will be his last game, redshirting, and then, you know, transferring or whatnot. And MJ's mom tweeting things, and yeah, just a bunch of weird stuff. I assume mostly message board. My take on this is I don't think Dave gives a crap. If MJ's going to give you the best chance to play, he's not going to worry about MJ's redshirt unless he just flat out refuses to play, which is a whole different story.
Yeah, if he pulls a Houston and says, I'm redshirting and I'm transferring.
Yeah, which I guess is possible, but damn, that'd be weird for a starting quarterback, right?
But how would you ever come back from that? Like, you'd have to transfer, right? Because if you go, well, let's say he wins, right? Let's just make it an easy situation. He beats Miami. He's 3-1 as the quarterback. We're bowl eligible. We may be ACC championship contending still. And he says, I'd like to redshirt, please, and not play the rest of this season. Who in their right mind, as a good football program, is going to be like, I want that kind of player? Who's going to trust him?
Yeah.
Right? Like, how does that work out? Now, let's say he loses this game. Okay, well, now you're 2-2. You beat Marshall. You beat Clemson. People are going to say you didn't do anything. KC did everything, basically, in all of those games. So what are you bringing into the portal? You had a little bit of a snap your first year. You got some interest from Auburn, supposedly. But now you just put out four pretty blah stat games. Again, like, who's going to sign up for that? And again, they're going to say, well, boy, it doesn't really look like he's... I don't know. Like, I feel like people are going to be really burned after this last transfer cycle, right? On quarterback in particular. Like, I just don't think...
But...
I personally would just find it a very confusing argument for his upside. It would make way more sense to just finish the season because, frankly, you could get injured next year and need that red shirt. So, like, I don't understand this concept of, like, this red shirt is so important.
Oh, well, the red shirts is ridiculous, but I guess it makes you a little more attractive because they have extra years. But I think it's all...
I mean, yeah, you can be like, hey, we're going to bring you in, and you're going to red shirt like you were supposed to this year, right?
And I don't know what he put on tape that people are going to... wow about, but at the same time, if NC State were bringing in a guy who has shown some ability to win games, I mean, that's probably the fair way to put it, because he's won some games. He's come in and won last year and then again this year. I'd be excited about it, so I can see where people get, there's upside here, we can coach him up, we can blah blah blah. So I don't know if anybody's feeling burned by the portal.
Yeah. I think a lot of people are going to say, should we really be giving so much money to these guys? Like, I mean, I think there's – the quarterback portal is going to be really interesting. Like, if Brendan Armstrong wasn't a surefire thing, right? He had some flags. So MJ flags, right?
Yeah.
The only person I could think of, right, would be like a Caleb Williams or someone like that, where you're like, that makes sense. We'll throw everything at that.
Caleb Williams.
I will take that, right? You know what I'm saying? Like, that is a known thing, and like the only reason that would happen is if whatever, for whatever extenuating circumstance. So that's why I kind of sit here and just scratched my head this morning when I saw these takes flying off the shelf, because all of a sudden it was like, well, you know what? Maybe MJ isn't that good, and maybe Brennan Armstrong, you know, MJ would have probably lost us the UConn game. You know, maybe Brennan would have won this. Brennan would have done, and it's like, okay, like, you guys are already mentally preparing yourself for this outcome, which may not even happen. I just, if he did it, I would just be like, all right, dude, see ya. I can't imagine anyone on the team would want to spend a fucking minute talking to you, buddy. So I would say pack the locker, get out. Like, you know, if you're going to abandon the team like that, to, you know, I think it's going to be a pretty quick see you later, buddy. And then you better hope like hell that Brennan Armstrong stays healthy the rest of the year and nuts out a win for you in that situation. It just doesn't make any sense to me.
Yeah. It doesn't to me. Yeah, it doesn't mean it's not going to happen. Because, you know, what started as a message board rumor starting to hit my text messages. And typically when that happens, there's a little bit more fire to the smoke. So, I don't know. It'll be... Like, and I'll say this. I don't know what's going to happen. But I know that if this is even a thing that's being discussed, right? Even if it is maybe 20% real, you can understand why Dave would hang it up and why other coaches would hang it up when they're not that old. Oh. Right? Who wants to deal with this nonsense?
I would think it would. No. I mean, I think Dave would bench his ass. He wouldn't even play this game.
Well, sure. But it's the thing. It's the stuff you're thinking about. It's. Yeah. I don't know. I just. It's just one more piece of BS that a head coach has to deal with.
I think the thing is it's not like it's money related. He got taken care of this offseason. So if it's, well, we brought someone in and he turned out to be a selfish prick, well, I'm just not going to bring in a guy like that again. You know, I think it's kind of easily handled that way. It would just be such a bizarre outcome. It would make more sense if it was the end of the year. We were not bowl eligible. It was like the last game. Even then, it wouldn't make that much sense. But it would make sense going into a bowl if he was like, you know, actually, I feel like I'm going to transfer and I'm not going to play. And they'd be like, you know what? Cool. We're going to let Brennan play if Brennan wants to. It just doesn't make any sense. And I just wonder if, I mean, maybe James heard something, but I also just wonder if James wrote that up in his column because he's like, well, you know, technically he could redshirt if he wants to. And maybe it was just like a throwaway comment, and now it's gained legs because if there's anything we're good at as fans, it's wringing our hands. And
I always tell James he's king troll. But a lot of times he does it when, you know, hey, it can happen or things can happen. He usually knows. Right, he usually knows. So sometimes it's coincidence. A lot of times it's not when these things get brought up. So
I don't know.
I hadn't asked him about it, so I really don't know. But
honestly, it would be so gratifying of an experience to then have to see the fans immediately be like, "Oh, we can't boo Brennan Armstrong anymore because apparently this other kid was the asshole the whole time." Like, okay. Is the argument, let's game this out. Is the argument they're not letting me throw the ball into dangerous situations and throw deep balls, so I'm going to leave, even though we just beat Clemson, which is an achievement any year. I don't care, right? But what would be the argument?
It's not playing time, right? Because you're playing, but unless you don't like the system you're playing in, maybe you didn't like a nine, you know, new offensive coordinator.
Wow.
Maybe he has ties to somebody somewhere else. Who knows? Like, who knows these days?
Yeah, I remember Brennan Armstrong said that he hated Anai the first year or two that he was under him, and so I wonder if Anai just like really rubs these guys. Hard. Well, that boy, I gotta be careful how I say that. really rubs these guys the wrong way to try to get the best out of them, kind of thing. And, Brennan was like, he appreciated him after the fact for it, but I think he said it. He was like, I just hated him that first year. And, yeah, I don't know. It just seems like such a weird thing. Oh, I'm gonna retain my red shirt. Okay. See ya, dude. You played six games. Or seven games at that point in your career. Have fun, but I don't know. It doesn't make sense to me. This seems like just much to do about nothing, and people just speculating.
Yeah.
But if it comes out, then it's just like, cool, man. Like, you're dead to me.
Yeah, I mean, he's replaceable. They're all replaceable. There's nobody I think is not. I mean, you're going to bring in a guy from the portal to play quarterback this offseason. Just get it right. That's all I'm asking. Get it right. I don't care who it is.
Yeah.
You didn't get it right this year. I get the risk, and it was calculated, you know, offensive coordinator hire, et cetera. It wasn't the right he wasn't the right guy, so do better next time.
You know what, though? After this game, you could put Brennan Armstrong in. I bet he could win all those games. There's nothing scary after this game.
Well,
he's played at Virginia Tech Brennan, on the road. He's played at UCLA.
Let Brennan do what MJ was doing, which is handing the ball to KC and getting the ball in, you know, in the space or whatnot. Now, he doesn't throw a good deep ball. MJ throws a pretty good deep ball. At least he was throwing it. You know, there's some different things, but, you know, they were letting MJ do things they were not letting Brennan do. I agree. I think he could come back. You could simplify things. You could just freaking play the old Kentucky Wildcat offense and let him run.
Yeah. You know,
or run some kind of option and be okay. Just get the ball to guys who can play. That's it. Not hard.
And he would, honestly, Brennan Armstrong would benefit from having the offensive line settle down like it has been the last few games. As far as at least the bodies are back from injury. And I think when we had a competent offensive line, it didn't look like the first few games that Brennan was really like that. I was saying he had some unfortunate throws against Notre Dame and, you know, just some, like we were kind of saying before, right? We just weren't hitting the easy button, or we didn't know we had the easy button in KC to the degree we did. So you could do that, and you add his ability to run. Like, yeah, I do think things actually work out fine. And if MJ doesn't want to stay here, then I'd rather the change be made for Miami. You know what I mean? Like, if someone's not invested going into this Miami week, then it doesn't serve us to play him either. You know, so that's, I don't know. We don't have to worry about that because we know that would happen because the betting line would just like all of a sudden go crazy if something like that was to occur. And I'm guessing it hasn't.
Right. Yeah, certainly. Some of these other questions. Miami's listed as a favorite in this game at 6 on ESPN app. Do you take the over, the under, or NC State for the win?
Has that come down?
Must have come down a little
what
bit.
What did that open at?
I thought it was like 7 or 6.5.
Yeah, hold on a sec. Now I'm kind of a little curious. Miami, NC State odds. Yeah, I know this is what people love, is hearing us do this. check Odds Shark real quick. The spread, opening spread was -4 Miami. Now it's -6 Miami. Maybe they know something, Evan.
You said it opened at what?
It opened at -4, and it's at -6 now.
I mean, people are aware of our offense issues.
Over-under went down 1.5 points.
What's the over-under?
44 now.
Under. I'll take the under. I took the under in the Clemson game. That was easy. Even though it was closer than I thought it was going to be.
Yeah.
I'll take the under here.
I'm thinking. I mean, I think we win this game. I haven't seen anything special from Miami. I think Clemson, if Cade Klubnik doesn't YOLO that last play, I feel like one more overtime sequence is going and that game changes, because all Miami could do was basically run the ball. So yeah, I'm going to say, boy, what's that score got to be if it's 44 with a -6? What are they, 24-18. Yeah, I think we're going to score like 35 points in this game. I think we're going to show out. I think Miami's going to be a little tired. I think they're going to be looking ahead. I think it's going to be a night game. the juice is going to be flowing. Their quarterback's going to make mistakes. Tony Gibson says, I don't care about those zone stats, and he's going to blitz every single play. And they're going to break Tyler Van Dyke in half by the second quarter. Brendan Armstrong comes off the bench to start the game, and we find out that MJ Morris is a terrible person. And Brendan Armstrong throws for like 400 yards, laughs at Bane as he stiff arms him and waltzes into the end zone. Have I painted the picture yet? So when we lose this game 3-35 or whatever, you guys can remember how high I was for
this game. Take the under. That's what he's saying. Take the under.
Even then in the loss, I just painted it, right? 38 points, yeah.
Yeah, take the under. I'll take the under on the rest of our games. I don't care what the spread is going to be. Just based on the fact that I don't know what our offense is going to do week to week.
Yeah, that seems fair.
Yeah.
How have the overs gone or over-unders gone for us all season? Has anyone tracked it?
I'm sure somebody has. I have no idea. The ones I've been on have been under.
Yeah, I'd be curious to see what this over... I want to see what the lines are tomorrow. It's been basically creeping up a point a day, kind of, is what it's been doing.
I think the in-game props have been my new entertainment. You know, who's going to score touchdowns?
It's too dangerous.
Over-under yardage. I think we have a little bit of inside there. I didn't expect Casey to blow out like he did last game, but... Delbert Mims getting a couple TDs is usually a good prop bet.
That seems fair. Yeah.
Do we have over 200 yards of total offense in this game?
Yes, I think actually. Again, I think this is going to be a more... I think it's going to be a little bit of reversion back to normal. It does seem... Maybe just the ACC has a bunch of bad quarterbacks and all that I'm seeing, but... It really does seem like a lot of passing attacks have really regressed this year, stats-wise. It seems like I'm watching games and they're like, the quarterback has 250 yards and they're acting like it's 400 yards from a couple years ago. I'm curious if something's going on there schematically across the game.
What activities is Will going to do on Saturday instead of watching the game? Bed Bath & Beyond, Home Depot, will he have time?
I just don't know if I have time. I just don't know. It sucks because that's the problem with 8 p.m. games. I run out of chores by that time. So
be forced to watch for boredom.
Yeah, the chore might be like, can I, you know, how many ice cubes can I make? I don't know. I'll watch this one live. I'll ride or die with us. The only way out would be if I can, like, watch a movie or something with my wife. And even then, I end up looking at the ESPN broadcast throughout the movie, so that'll be ruined. But yeah, we'll see. I'm going to try to fertilize the yard tomorrow, you know? That's my big goal tomorrow.
That's another great question. When we win the game to... This is so funny. When we win the game due to end-of-game mismanagement by Mario Cristobal, will Salty Dave flex on him in Spanish? Yo soy Salido, Dave. I can't even read the rest of it. Asperito contra mi con. I can't even pronounce that one. My Spanish is rusty.
Donde está life wallet or whatever.
No, yeah. Dave will be very contrite to Mario. He has no beef with him.
He'll be like a hard fought game to real physical teams. If Dave has a sense of humor, he's going to say that was two championship caliber teams or whatever James Franklin said. Yeah. After the Ohio State game. I think Dave's going to be just breathing a sigh of relief if he gets through this part of the schedule and have gone 2-1 against Duke, Miami, and Clemson. I think he'll probably light up a cigar right then.
He should be thrilled.
Yeah. He'll be the opposite of Kyle Whittingham. He'll be like, we care about bowls here.
How can State exploit Miami's D? Is their D better than Clemson? Should the game plan be to be down by three with a minute left and see if they refuse to take a knee?
I think he just...
Like I said, I think you got to get away from Bane. I think he is so disruptive. and don't make the offensive line try to pass block. That's where Miami's going to live. I think they're probably a comparable defense to Clemson's. I think Clemson's is probably better top to bottom and better organized. And clearly by the point totals we just rattled off, Miami's giving up some points to, giving up points to Virginia, and Clemson's offenses probably shouldn't be doing that. So, I don't know. I think, again, it's going to be – I just watch that Bane kid, man. He's so fun to watch. He's just powerful, and he is going to be disruptive. And we're gonna need the defense to score. I just got a feeling that's one of those things that's going to happen.
Definitely. So, definitely got to win the turnover margin. This is definitely a turnover margin game. What I would say, what I noticed with Virginia is the second they got a first down, they would do hurry up, and it was really effective. Early on against Miami. And so I would just take advantage of it. If you're going to have those big bulky dudes or a guy like Bain and those who have probably got logged a lot of snaps in the last 2 weeks and haven't had the bye week to refresh, between these games, I would just, this would be a great game, I think, for tempo, assuming you can get a first down and get it moving. But I would love to see us try to take advantage of that. Again, I think Clemson, before we played them, was averaging like 15 points per game before overtime. And so it looks like Miami right now is 28th in the country, 20 points a game. Clemson dropped down to 21 for reference after playing us. So I think it's going to be kind of similar. I think it really is going to come down to, can you limit their defense from making explosive plays and living in the backfield? Because we had Clemson, I think, had like 8 tackles for loss or 8 sacks. I can't remember what it was from last game, right? But there was a ton of pressure in the backfield, and we did too. But I guess what I would say is, like, so far I haven't really seen MJ completely melt back there, and I do think that if Tyler Van Dyke is off or if they put in a backup quarterback, I think that's going to bode very well for us. But, again, it's just, can we fight our tendencies? I don't know. I mean, we could go out there and blitz like hell and it pays off the whole game, but it just really seems like there's a known quantity with defensive coordinators across the ACC in 3 games, having just sat back in coverage and Tyler Van Dyke just completely looking clueless, that I really hope we try to do the same thing. But knowing us, we're going to let those wide receivers get ISO on us and do something silly is my guess, but
yeah, I'm still not worried about that. I guess if they do, all right. If we're too aggressive, I guess that's my concern. Like you already said, I'm just rarely worried about another team's wide receivers taking advantage of us. We just hadn't seen it all year. It's just other parts of the game that have been, in flux.
Yeah. It all works as long as we don't let up a big run, right? And that's why I was saying, like, it's important to have Peyton Wilson back. I hope he's back for this game, obviously, because the defense did look a little different without him. But I think Tony's answer at the end of the game was like, well, we'll just be aggressive if we're not going to have him. So that'll be good to see. Again, special teams is going to be interesting. Their kicker and our kicker, very good season so far. Just keep an eye on that. I think it's going to be a really physical game. I think unfortunately, this is like one of those coaches, like with those BC games and others, where it's like, I guarantee you, Dave and them are going to just have a hard on trying to out-physical this team instead of just, finesse your way around them. I mean, I think Tez Walker really went off against Miami. So, again, can KC be that guy and just be explosive? Yeah. If Clemson had any pulse on offense, they probably would have won that game without a problem. Right? I think actually they went up maybe like 2 scores to start that game too.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I think Miami may – I'm not going to say paper tiger, right? But they may be less formidable than you'd think, and we just need to play a clean game. I really hope we I like that we huddled last game, and I kind of hope we do the same thing because it seemed like the offensive line in particular benefited from that. So I don't know, just take what you did last game and keep hitting the button.
Well, there we have it, folks. We did an hour about the Miami Hurricanes.
God. We were so close.
54 minutes, 55 minutes.
Oh, no, we're under? Yeah. Okay, okay.
Yeah, we're under. Yeah, we're under. Of course, naturally. I got nothing else. It'll be fun. Every game's a roller coaster with us right now, and I can't tell you anybody knows what to expect. Other than Casey's really good and he'll probably do good things. So that's my analysis. And watch Bane, because I watched the Bane kid. I think it was Clemson. He straight power cleaned a kid and just tossed him out of the way. And I'm like, holy poop, he's a freshman. Unbelievable.
Yeah, that's
unbelievable.
That's what's crazy.
Yeah,
He's probably on roids.
Yeah. Probably.
That's right. I said it.
Rude. All right, folks. That's all I got. As always, thanks for listening. Probably won't be a space after the game. It's probably too late unless we do something insane one way or the other. But we'll be talking about it in the pod chat. We will be watching it, I'm sure. As always, thanks for listening. Thanks for supporting the pack. Go check out the pods we did early in the week. They're not really time sensitive. One is basketball related. Matt Coe is back. And, you know, the Clemson post game was more about us and Dave and everybody else. So if you haven't listened already, which I'm sure you have, go back and check them out. But thanks for supporting us. Go Pack.
Go Pack.